let's talk about the inner life and the outer life. One thing that strikes me as so powerful about your mission in the world is that you seem to successfully broker both of those worlds.
You must take off the word broker.
You successfully pursue both of those worlds, if you will. The Isha Foundation educates the young and plants trees. And then you also teach people about inner engineering. And I think that could be a challenge for we in the West. We in the West perhaps love the outer world and maybe at the expense of the inner world, but I'd love to hear your perspective on that.
See, all these massive projects of health, education and ecology that we are doing in southern India have mainly happened only because of an inner experience. There are millions of people who had a powerful inner experience. It's out of that we are able to generate this action, because these massive projects are all completely done by a volunteer force. Volunteers means nobody's trained for the job. And you cannot fire them for inefficiency because they're volunteers. At the same time, even if they're holding a key position at any time, without notice they can just vanish. You manage an organization like this, you will go crazy in no time. That's my job. So, having described my job, which is a sure route to madness, if I was not as well established as I am within myself, it would have driven me bonkers. Because I've managed businesses before, and at that time I used to wield my authority on people to get things going. And the main thing was, they were on my, you know, I was doing the payment for them. That was the main control. Now I don't make any payment for anybody, everybody is not paid, nobody is paid. In fact, they spend their own money and come and do everything to keep them going. Is essentially the inner engineering, because there is a powerful experience within which drives them to do all this work. It is unfortunate that people always trying to divide the world. You must understand this, that the very basic nature of human intellect is this. Human intellect, you know, all of you, the sharper it is, the better it is, isn't it so? You should agree with me. The sharper it is, the better it is, I think. Intellect.
Oh. I actually want to talk about being a prophet.
Yeah, well, I don't go that far. Let's finish the project.
Let's go there. So, because one of the things about being mindful of the inner life...
You cannot be mindful of the inner life. Now you... talked about being a prophet. Now I can say no.
So I don't think I wouldn't say you're a prophet. I'm talking about the Judeo-Christian tradition of prophecy. So, in the Hebrew Bible, in the Old Testament, there is the role of those who speak truth to power, who speak out against injustice, who sacrifice themselves for a cause. Because of injustice. And there, in that narrative, there is anger and there is rage. And there are significant groups of people in the world, in our country, who have due cause to be angry about the world. The refugee, the ethnic minority, the poor. And one thing about inner engineering and sort of finding peace within oneself, the other side of that coin is, you know what, is there ever a time to be angry, to march, to be enraged at the injustice of the world? What would you say to that?
You know, Che, I know you, this is not a popular name in America. Che Guevara said, if you're enraged, you're one of us. I said, if you're out of rage, you're one of us. If you're really out of rage, you're definitely one of us, because you think there is a reason for your anger, which is a wrong perception. If you look at it, people get terribly angry with their loved ones. There's a whole lot of violence within the homes, because they get terribly angry with their loved ones, somebody that they're living with, and they have a good reason to get angry, because she did not cook the breakfast properly, or the dog peed where it's not supposed to pee. Or I have seen people yelling and screaming and breaking their clubs on a golf course where they're just having a good time. So I'm saying everybody has a reason to be angry. Anger means just this. When you're angry, as a doctor, you know today that when you're angry, literally you're generating poison in the system, literally. If you are poisoning yourself internally, and when you're angry, you know you do the most idiotic things in your life. When you turn back and see, you can't believe you did it. But most idiotic things happen when you're angry. So I'm asking, is anger an intelligent expression of human life or an idiotic expression of human life? Hello? Idiotic. So that's all you need to know. The next time you're angry, you just know you're stupid. Because you're turning against yourself. But I will tell you, the reason why this anger has been eulogized is, in a moment of anger, some people who were sleeping all their life propelled themselves into action, and that action produced some results. Yes, that can happen. It may so happen, you know, that if I throw a stone at you, instead of hitting you, it hit the apple in the tree and the apple fell into your hands, but that's by accident. Generally, if I throw a stone, your head will crack. That's what is supposed to happen. Yes? So I got angry and something got done. So I think anger is a great way of doing things. So when you're angry, you yell and fume at somebody. I'm asking all of you, how many of you enjoy being yelled at and fumed by somebody else, whether it's your boss or your husband or your wife or your parents or anybody? You really thoroughly enjoyed this. Hello? Did you? No. And what makes you think somebody else enjoys it? They endure you, they don't enjoy you. And when they're done, they're done. So, it doesn't matter whether the anger happened to a man that you call as a prophet, because we have a way of eulogizing everything with which we have a distance of time. Suddenly, anything which is over 1,000 years becomes sacred in most people's mind, but whatever is happening right now, however great it is, they don't have the intelligence to recognize this. People are saying the past things are great simply because everybody else is saying it. Not because they truly recognize, but we are coming to a time. If you don't do it, your children will do this. That is, a time is coming in the world where, unless it makes sense, it doesn't matter from what source it comes from. Even if God comes and speaks here, the next generation will reject it unless it makes sense to them. This is a good development, because instead of authority being the truth, truth is becoming the authority. It's a good way to go. But once this happens, questions are going to rise, all kinds of questions. With all due respect to every religious tradition on the planet, I come from a land which has immense traditions, unbelievable. Most people in the world, most Indians are not even conscious of this. How many traditions, how many ways are there in that land? When Mark Twain came to India, he said, anything that can ever be done, either by man or God, has been done in this land, because the exploration is so incredible. But with all due respect to all of them, I say this, that if you raise three fundamental questions, 90% of the scriptural knowledge on the planet will collapse. I'm sorry, but this is the truth. If you ask three pertinent questions, you will see 90% of the scriptural knowledge on the planet will just collapse, it can't stand scrutiny.
So what are the three questions?
You are not a scripture, so why should I?
Oh no, you said ask three questions.
Yes, the fundamental questions. If you ask, simply, you see, the fundamental thing is this. You don't know where you came from. You don't know where you will go. You can believe. If we work hard enough on you, we can make you believe anything. You must know this. I was just talking to a group of people in Nashville, Tennessee, where our center is. I was just telling them a joke. In the joke, I referred to God as Him. Immediately a few ladies stood up and said, do you believe God is a man? I said, whoa, 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 I know what I've gotten into, you know. I said, I was just telling you a joke. He said, it doesn't matter, you said Him. Now this is a debate in America, is God a man or a woman? I think this time in the election they're trying to settle that issue. But where we come from, we have no such issue. We have a man god, we have a woman god, we have a cow god, we have an elephant god, we have a snake god, we have a bird god, we have a dog god, we have every kind. Crawling ones, creeping ones, flying ones, all kinds. Because we are a very wise culture. We foresaw all the future problems that may arise. And there is also a debate which in the last election they tried to settle, but it did not settle, I think. People are debating in southern churches, is God black or white? It's a big serious debate happening. People really debating about this, is God white or black? Well, you know, Idi Amin, the Uganda man, Idi Amin declared God is black. I agree with him. That if a white man can have a white man, white God, why can't a black man have a black God? But you know, these people do not know, because in these parts of the world, only messiahs, prophets, sons, others came. They don't know. In India, we know God is brown. Because God Himself visited India 9 times. Are you aware of this? You didn't know. God visited India 9 times, Himself. Indians are very proud of this because God visited us Himself 9 times and He sent His son and messenger and others to other places. I keep reminding them that's because God wanted to do the job hands-on with Indians. He couldn't trust anybody else with Indians. He came 9 times and He failed. No, coming to believe, I'm saying we can make people believe anything if you work upon them from their childhood. Anything, believe me. You just have to work hard enough and make them believe this, that, everything. Belief gives you a confidence without clarity. Confidence without clarity is a disaster on this planet. There is no substitute for clarity. There is no substitute for clarity. But If you have confidence, you can just do something, just like that. Sometimes it works. Even if you're not clear, you can simply do something and it'll work. Can I tell you a joke?
Please.
This happened in New York City. Late afternoon, an 8-year-old boy came back from school. He had a very progressive mother, obviously she was single. I'm saying they couldn't… nobody catch up with her. He came home and he asked, "Mama, is God man or woman?" She thought about all the gender issues and the coming election and everything. And then she thought about it for a while and she said, "Both." The boy went into deep thought. After a little while, the boy came back and asked, "Mama, is God black or white?" Again she thought about all the racial issues in the country and after considering this at length, she said, "Both." The boy went into very deep thought. Then after some time he came back and asked, "Mama, is God straight or gay?" She again thought about it and then she said, "Both." The boy jumped in joy, "I got it, I got it, it's Michael Jackson." So how we arrived at our belief has cultural backing. Every culture has made up their own stuff. But I'm asking, do we genuinely know where we came from and where we're going? If you're so clear where you're going, that is for an appointment with the Creator, I don't think you should postpone the appointment. You must take it today, isn't it? But that's not true. If death is next moment, you don't want to go. If you are so sure, only that fanatic who blows himself up seems to be sure. Everybody else has a doubt, isn't it? Every working intelligence has a doubt, yes or no? If you have frozen your intelligence with overriding belief systems, then you're going. Every other working intelligence, if death is next moment, there is hesitation or no? For sure, isn't it? Because you really don't know where you're going. You can believe what you want, but you really do not know. Belief is of social significance, to some extent of psychological significance, but existentially it means nothing.
Can I ask your thoughts on this? In some ways, in many ways, we are the inheritors of our tradition. And they can, and they do influence us and shape us. Is there a positive role for the traditions from whence we come? For example, if I'm gonna try to inner engineer my inner life and try to get some direction and meaning and faith and hope and values, I can't do it alone. And there are rich traditions, Hindu traditions, Judeo-Christian traditions, Muslim traditions that give some context, some meaning, some structure upon which to anchor my life. What do you think about that? Do we throw away all the traditions and inner engineer our lives, or can we use these traditions?
As you said, to anchor our lives. Now that is the decision that every human being has to make. Do you want to be anchored or do you want to set sail? That is a decision that everybody has to make. If you're looking for confidence, if you're looking for stability, then you have to anchor yourself to something. If you're looking to go far, then anchoring will not help. Traditions. All traditions, with all due respect to all of them, particularly traditions that are coming from India, and also elsewhere. I'm not in any way an expert on to make a comment on the traditions that you're talking about, but essentially tradition means this. What somebody did yesterday is today's culture and tradition. What you do today is tomorrow's culture and tradition. I'm asking you, how much of what we're doing today in this world and in this country is consciously cultured? But all the rubbish that we do will become tomorrow's culture and tradition of this land, isn't it so? Hello? I'm saying, do you believe that people who lived here 1,000 years ago were such super human beings, they did everything perfectly and you're doing everything wrong? It's not so. They were also just people like you. We have a way of elegizing everything with which we have a certain distance of time. But are they of no value? Not true. There are a whole lot of things that we as human beings simply know today, which is thanks to the traditions in which we have grown up. We cannot say no. But if you want to know this life, which is myself, no tradition is… Tradition can inspire you. Tradition can put you in a direction. Tradition cannot take you there because this has to happen now to you. Only then it's a living reality for you. Otherwise you will read in a book and believe it. But how do you know this works? I'm saying it should work. People ask me, Sadhguru, how do we know whether we have met a real teacher or a guru or not? I just tell them, look at his face, huh? Whether it's worked for him, what he's talking. Has it worked for him? That's all the question. If it's worked for him, it doesn't matter what it is, you must go with him because it's worked for him. If it's not worked for him, what is the point? Dead tradition.
So one of the traditions here in a medical school, in a Western medical school, is the tradition of the evidence. Show me. And this tradition, which is only really maybe 200 or 300 years old, the randomized controlled trial, the cohort study, the all of that, and it's good. You know, that's how we've gotten cures for, you know, pneumonia and drugs to help alleviate pain. You know, it's all been done through this pursuit of the evidence. And also I'm a pastor and I fully embrace the life of the Spirit and the truth that we find in our faith traditions. And I love that tradition. But I do recognize a tension, if you will, between the truth that we discover in the lab and the truth that we discover in our spirit. And I love that tension. I think that's a great it's a great way to live in a way, that sort of loving, joyful pursuit that is both the truth that I see around me and the love that grows in my heart. But I do recognize the tension. What is your perception of that?
So when we talk about the evidence-based approach, it is not a tradition. When it happened, when the Renaissance happened, it was breaking of all traditions. Till then, because it was written in a book, because a certain authority was espousing it, we said, this is it. When medical science evolved from Jenner to others, the fundamental thing was they broke all tradition. So now if that is becoming a tradition, I'm very sorry, because this was an exploration. An exploration cannot be traditional. An exploration means you're constantly trying to step into new terrain. That's what an exploration is. But if that has become traditional, then we are treading the same track and thinking it's exploration. This evidence-based approach has done wonders to many, many things, no question. But this entire process is dependent upon the human intellect. This is what we were just coming to, but we went off a little bit. human intellect by nature. I was just asking you, would you like it sharp or blunt? Hello? You want it sharp. If you have a sharp instrument, let's say you have a knife in your hand, what could you do with this flower? With a knife? You could cut it finely if you want, but you can cut it into pieces. That's exactly what the intellect does. Whatever you give it, it will cut it open and try to see. The way of evidence-based science is dissection, fundamentally. Well, even in the medical school, I'm sure, the pathology labs, we are opening up, fortunately, the dead. But if you really want to know somebody, someone whom you love very much, if you really want to know them, I think you should dissect them to know them. Would it work like that? No, obviously. So, there is one dimension of life which is physical in nature, where dissection will work. But what is physical about you, the body that you carry, is an accumulation that you gathered over a period of time. It's just the food that you've eaten. It is actually a piece of the planet. Most people don't get this when they're walking. But the countless number of people who walked on this planet before you and me, they are all topsoil today. You and me also will be topsoil, unless your friends choose to bury you real deep, fearing that you may raise from the dead. This is just the soil, isn't it? Hello? This is just the soil that you walk upon. So this is an accumulation. What you gather, what you accumulate, you can claim it is mine. You cannot say it's me, isn't it? Right now as I'm speaking, I say, this is my glass. You will think, oh, Sadhguru seems to have a problem. But let's listen, everybody says he's wise. After some time, I'll say, this is me. Then you will say, let's go. Because if I claim this is me, you know, it qualifies for madness, isn't it? Whatever you acquire, you can say, this is mine. But if you say, this is me, this is madness. Yes or no? Are there any psychiatrists? Does this qualify? It does. So, every day you're doing this, food appeared on your plate, you said, this is my food, you ate it and then you say, it's me. This is madness. But you have enormous company. And we believe in democracy. Whatever the majority says must be right. So, it is going on. But the moment you believe something that is not you as yourself, you kind of lost it. You derail from life. So, turning inward does not mean dissection. Turning inward does not mean contemplation. Because the content of your body and the content of your mind is an accumulated substance, isn't it? You gathered it from outside. What you gather from outside can be yours, but can never ever be you. So, we're talking about inner engineering, not as twisting and turning the body, not about taking on new attitudes of love or generosity, compassion, whatever great values and emotions that a human being can have. I see all that as a consequence of a certain way of being, rather than looking at it as a means to get somewhere. Everywhere people are talking about whatever… See, if you deprive somebody of something for a period of time, simple qualities will raise to heaven. Today, anywhere you go, people are talking, peace of mind is the ultimate goal of human life. Why? Because they're freaked out in their minds. Why would peace be the highest goal? Because you're talking about Judeo-Christian thing, the origin of where it came from. I happened to be in Tel Aviv. I was to get there that morning and speak at 6:30 in the evening. I was flying in from Atlanta, because of some delays in the flights, I landed there at 6 in the evening. So I'm quickly changing in the airport, because in these 35 years I have not been late to a single appointment. I don't want to break that, so I'm rushing. And I'm famished, because I'm traveling an American airline and there's nothing edible on the plane. I'm super hungry and I rush to the venue. And to my joy, I find the talk is in a fine restaurant. Life can't get better. So as I went in, people are greeting me and one man comes up and says, "Shalom." I ask him, "What does it mean?" He says, "This is the highest way of greeting." I said, "Well, that's your opinion, but what does it mean?" He said, "No, this is the highest way of greeting." I said, "That's all right, but what does the word mean?" He said, "It means peace." I said, "Why would peace be the highest way of greeting unless you're born in Middle East?" In South India, you come up to me in the morning and say, "Peace." I'll say, "What's wrong with you?